Hey, greetings to you all cherished viewers, lovely people, lovers of aviation history, all the aviation enthusiasts. Welcome to yet another series, Dancing with the Aero DDs, under the theme, A Date with the Aero Archives. Today, the spotlight will be on Thomas Selfridge. And before we continue with the objectives, don't forget to tell a friend, to tell a friend, to tell another friend that Captain Amwa is here with another banger. And don't forget to like, comment, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. And we'll be doing the objectives very shortly. Thomas Selfridge, our objectives today, we are going to continually appreciate the previous Aero Daredevils and what they did. I'll take some time to walk you back into history. We are also going to look at the background to the crash. What happened? The post-crash events. And also, how are we, or what's the criteria that we are using to admit Thomas Selfridge into the sphere, the space, or the membership of Aero Daredevils. Okay, so we'll just read this, a bit of his bio and what happened. Then I'll take my time to let you understand why we are admitting him to the Hall of Aero Daredevils. Thomas Selfridge, nothing much is said about his birth, but he was a military officer. Bear in mind that after the events of 17th December 1903, the floodgates, if I should say, opened and admitted so many Aero Daredevils, including the Wright brothers themselves. The other Aero Daredevils wanted to manufacture aircrafts which could outcompete what the Wright brothers did on 17th December 1903. The Wright brothers themselves were also part of the Aero Daredevils from that January 1st, 1904, also trying to make aircrafts better than what they invented in 1903 to jumpstart the aviation's birthday. The Wright brothers were part of them, and there were other Aero Daredevils like Henry Farman that we've studied in the previous videos, Louis Blériot, and the rest of them. So, something interesting happened in this Thomas Selfridge bio. What happened was that all these feats of the previous Aero Daredevils I mentioned, and many more, their activities began to catch the attention of military personnel. Because remember, prior to the World War I history, that's 1914, military was just land, sea. Land, sea. But with the activities of these Aero Daredevils from January 1st, 1904, all the way to about 1907, the military began to get interested in the activities. And what happened was, they said, you know what, why don't we also order these aircrafts, learn how to fly them, and use them for reconnaissance? You know, reconnaissance is a very major activity in the military. That is, going to a certain area to study the area, gather some information for their intelligence, basically. And they shorten it by what you call recce. So, as these Aero Daredevils that we've mentioned in the past were doing what they were doing, the military guys started to get interested and said, okay, I think we also need aircraft just for reconnaissance mission. At that time in 1907, reconnaissance was just enough. But later I'll let you know how come they went beyond reconnaissance. But up until 1907, they also started to put things into place and try to see how they could also fly aircrafts for reconnaissance missions as part of their work as military officers. They also started observing what the other guys were doing. They were also going to the racing parks, or as we mentioned in previous videos, the aerodromes. They were going to those aerodromes to go and observe what they were doing. And the more they went, just like anything in the human evolution, the more they went, the more interested they became. So what happened was, there was a day where the military appointed Lieutenant Thomas Selfridge, who we are studying now, to be an observer in one of the Wright brothers' aircraft for military purposes. The contract was that if they were supposed to go four circuits or four rounds around the aerodrome of test, and if the aircraft could pass in certain maneuvers, which I'll explain later, they were going to give the Wright brothers a contract to manufacture more for the military. And that, obviously, that's good business for the Wright brothers or any other manufacturer. You know, for a military guy to observe the performance of an aircraft and say, okay, you know what, I'm going to give you a contract, manufacture so many for us. So on this day, 17th September 1908, the day was scheduled for Thomas Selfridge to sit as a passenger. So he was supposed to sit to the right side of Orville Wright, observe the flying. Orville would do a little bit of maneuvers. He's impressed. He could go back to his unit and say, okay, you know what, let's give them the contract. That was the plan for the day. Everything seemed to be going uneventfully, and just when they were about to finish their last circuit, that, you know what they were supposed to do, just do four rounds around the aerodrome, they heard a tapping noise, and followed by two loud bangs, they realized that their propeller had gone faulty. Orville lost control of the aircraft, and they crashed into the aerodrome. Well, Lieutenant Thomas Selfridge, the one who was supposed to just observe and give the brothers the contract, died a few hours later after he had a fractured skull. So a few hours later, Thomas Selfridge died. And that recorded him in the aviation history books as the first passenger to die in a crash. Orville, who even survived, he also had injuries in his skull, a fractured thigh, a couple of broken hips. Broken hip, a fractured thigh, and an injured skull. Even he, the survivor. And that put that story to bed. Now, it's very interesting that just after the crash, the one who took over, or if I should say, who succeeded Lieutenant Thomas Selfridge to plan another assessment for contract for the Wright brothers, just told the Wright brothers, you know what, in spite of what has just happened and everything, we are just convinced, we are more than convinced that you guys can manufacture an aircraft which is good for us, so go ahead with the contract. Why is Lieutenant Thomas Selfridge a dead devil? Why? In our previous videos, when we started dealing with the aero daredevils, I told you who is an aero daredevil. An aero daredevil in this case are people who go out there to perform a maneuver or something without hindsight. No one went before them, so they couldn't even say, okay, you know what, I can foresee XYZ happening, so I'm going to do ABC. And obviously, without any hindsight, you can never have foresight. Obviously, they had no foresight. And they didn't have any insight. Insight means that after you've got your hindsight and your foresight, you can design manuals, training programs, and other things to meet what you are going to do. Four rounds around an airport involves a lot of turns, climbs, descents, and so many things that you are going to subject the aircraft to bodily stress and other things. It's not just a jolly ride in the air, just sailing, smooth sailing, smooth air. No, the turns will involve a lot of aerodynamic things and to test the controls and things to see whether they perform properly. Today, whenever we're going for a test flight, we are more prepared than them. Because obviously we've had so much hindsight in the past, we've had so much foresight, we know what can happen, we have so much insight. Even in the aircraft itself, okay, in the aircraft itself, if there's a faulty propeller in today's aircraft, we have a certain, if I say, warning. Even the emergencies are divided into warning, cautions, and advisories. So in today's aircraft, if there's a problem with the controls or a problem with the propeller, and so what? It doesn't mean anything. All you have to do is that look at the warning, what it's telling you, pick up what we call the QRH, the quick reference handbook, and look at that topic. If it's under flight controls, if it's under engine or power plant, just flip through the checklist and you go to the exact problem that you've seen on your warning system. But remember, they didn't have manuals, they didn't have anybody go before them, they didn't have any insight, and that is why Lieutenant Thomas Selfridge was a daredevil. And also, he was not in the right apparel for a test, because normally if you're going to test these aircrafts as per that event, at least a parachute device, he should have been in a parachute device, and the aircraft should have been designed such that as it loses control, the two of them could bail out, as we say in our industry, come down safely to ground and just leave the aircraft to do whatever it has to do. Insurance will take care of it. They didn't have any hindsight. They did not have any foresight. And obviously, they didn't have insight. Even the normal flight, had it even been a normal flight. And that is why we are admitting Lieutenant Thomas Selfridge into the Hall of Aero Daredevils. And just like anything, and just like any evolution, human life, the more we understood what happened in on 17th, September 1908 and other casualties, the more we have improved the way we do things. So that's why we are admitting him into the Hall of Aero Daredevils. I hope this short history about Thomas Selfridge that you've seen on your screens will give you that appreciation that all these people and their unfortunate events led to the safety and comfort of aviation that we have today. I think we've done justice to Lieutenant Thomas Selfridge, and we've met the objectives of appreciating the previous aero daredevils. Some of them had minor crashes here and there themselves, but didn't die. And some of them also had broken hips and everything, but they continued. Even with the Wright brothers situation, he also still continued to do whatever he wanted to do, and he never gave up. All these guys, we say thank you and we continue to appreciate them. Had they not been in this space, we wouldn't have been in aviation now. So join us on future videos. There are going to be more exciting stories about other guys who did the unthinkable.